Our first speaker of the day is one many of you are probably already familiar with. He was born in Cairo, Egypt, at the age of and he stayed there until the age of 15, upon which he moved to Toronto in the late 1970s. Having a bachelor's in Sharia from the American International University, with an ijazah in Quran recitation, he is currently Director of Religious Affairs for ISNA Canada. Without further ado, I would like to invite Sheikh Ala Al-Sayyid.
Bismillah wa alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulullah amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. I don't want to give him a heart attack, sisters. First, I'd like to congratulate the Golden Youth Wallahi for putting on an event. It's not very easy, I assure you, to put on an event. It is a logistic nightmare. You have a lot of things that could go wrong, and you have all these things that have to put together. May Allah bless you, Wallahi. I encourage you highly and support you 100%. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it purely for his sake. And may Allah give you the strength to continue and improve on it, inshallah, till it becomes even one of the biggest, inshallah, events in Canada. Jazakumullah anna khayra. Don't thank Allah till you thank the people. So may Allah reward you also for coming here and supporting them with your time and effort and money. So hopefully, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala build a path for you to Jannah as you're building a path for you to acquire knowledge. And the glad tiding is that as we speak, brothers and sisters, the angels around us mention you by name to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who seek knowledge. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you, ameen. Now the topic. It's a beautiful topic indeed. In this life, you're connected. Whether it's an iPhone, iPad, iPod, iPad, Blueberry, Blackberry, Raspberry, whatever it is that you have, you're connected. You can't get away. It doesn't matter where you go. You can't be seen, touched, talked to. It doesn't matter where you are or how far you're in. It's always a way that you have to be connected. And you think about the phone that you have. And if you leave it at home, you feel lost. You have to go back and get it because it's your lifeline. I'm not connected to the outside world. And that is where we're going to go. That signal, that dash that you have on your left-hand screen or your top right, doesn't matter what it is, you always make sure that you have as many bars as you have. Or the Wi-Fi. How many bars do I have? So that is also your strength. And that's your strength of Iman. So how is your signal? You should be asking yourself. Is my signal strong or is my signal weak? Do I actually have to go out, I mean out of the environment, to get a stronger signal? Or can I stay in where I am and I actually can feel connected? And the only answer for that is that one that you own. You have to be honest with yourself. You can fool anybody, but you can't fool yourself. You can't certainly fool Allah. So you should be asking yourself, when I'm all alone, how is my connection to Allah? The reason I'm going there is because it's taqwa. Taqwa is one of the strengths and one of the bars. Khushu' is another bar that you have to work on. So we work on one bar at a time to get you full strength, inshallah, to be connected to Allah subhanahu wa jalla bi ula. So why am I hitting this? I want you to think that you're trying to get a signal. Some of us try to get to back home, whatever back home is, and we install a dish. A dish that can connect us to whatever that country of ours or origin, to make sure our kids learn our language. We still live there. I remember 35 years ago we came to this country thinking that I'm going to come to this country, make the money and get back. 35 years later, here's for hoping. Canada 2, us 0. And the battle goes on. You're trying to still make the money, you're trying to still go back home. So you get at least a signal, a dish that wants to connect you to whatever that you dream you want to go back. To your ancestors, your mother, your father, whatever that is. Or the grandmother or grandfather that kissed your cheek and go, coochie, coochie, coochie. Because you miss them so much. You don't even know who your children are. Sometimes you travel so much, you still gotta get connected. And you don't know the cousins. I hear that my cousin lives there. So you get that dish and you try to get somebody to install it. And that person brings up an odometer, some kind of a meter, that tries to pick up the signal. He moves the dish, or she moves the dish. You have to be politically correct, we're in Canada. So he or she has to move the dish to get that sound. You move it, you go, then you go, oh, that's a strong signal. He puts it there, locks it down. Because now he knows, or she knows, that is the strength of the signal. And what is that signal? It is direct to your heart and your iman. Similarly, I want you to think about that dish that you're moving is your heart. And where is it linked? To Mecca. Why? Because every Muslim around the world, no matter where they live, they actually get that signal, whatever they are, they face themselves and link toward their heart, toward Mecca. Toward that sacred home, the built that was the first house on the face of the earth by Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ishmael alayhi salam, to for everyone to follow no matter where. And that is your signal. So how is your signal in your heart? Are you really connected to it? Or do you just say, you know, mañana, when I have a chance? Now, where is this signal? If we agree that the Mecca is like the heart of the ummah, so how is your heart that is in the middle of your chest to you? If everybody is dying to go to Mecca to perform Hajj at least for once in their lifetime, and you go around, by the way, when the scholars say you go around this direction because your heart is closer to the Kaaba, not the other way around. So going back to your heart, how is it? Have you not heard the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that shaitan yajri minka majra al-dam? Shaitan runs in your veins. Some of the interpretation says as long as you're alive, as long as the blood runs in your veins, shaitan is working against you. But what purifies that blood? It's a small machine inside that's called your heart again. And that is the reason we're concentrating on that central focus point where the signal is strong or weak. Similarly with the dish, similarly with that, Masjid al-Haram. That is the signal you should be linked to. So, how is that ticker? Why? Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, At-taqwa ha-huna, at-taqwa ha-huna, at-taqwa ha-huna. Three times. He pointed to his heart. His taqwa is right here. It's right here. It's an internal, tangible or untangible expression or feel toward between you and Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula. So how will you know you have taqwa or not? How is this bloodstream? How is it purified? How is that engine of yours? How is the battery that takes you there? Make it or break it. Will you make it to the journey or will you stop short? Do you have enough fuel to carry on? Or do you stop? Or you follow a fad or a change? Are you a follower or a leader? So a chicken, a measuring stick for you to check your ticker. What is it? When you're all alone, as I said, the only time you will know whether you have taqwa or not, wallahi. When you're all alone, that is the only time you'll know whether you have taqwa or not. And you'll find out what you're made of. And what kind of heart do you have. So, how are you, akhi? In the masjid, like you're Abu Bakr. And when you're all alone, like you're Abu Jahl. So you go inside the room. You wait for your father and mother go to sleep. And you hear the footsteps as they lock the door. Now you go. It's party time. You open your laptop. Punch in some chats or some websites. And now you're talking to the sister from another mister. Hey, honey, how you doing? And the shaitan will tell you, know, you've got good intention. You want to marry the sister, you want to check it out, just making sure. Sure, I'll buy that. What are you wearing tomorrow? Because I want to match, because I want to make people know we're couples. You know that red dress of yours? Oh, that makes me, oh, my heart is aching because she doesn't eat bacon. It's true, I ain't bacon. My knees are shaking. What are you doing, dude? So you're talking, you're watching, and all of a sudden, your father opens the door. So instead of, hey baby, how you doing? Yes, Brother Muhammad, how are you? Well, tomorrow we'll talk about tajweed class, inshallah, in the Quran. I'll see you in the masjid, Abhi. Sure. That's one bar. Now I want you to think about the tangibles. We're giving you a roadmap, right? We're giving you solutions. So from now on, these are tangibles of the NFT. Your eyes are camera lenses. Your ears and mouth are your MP3. Your mind is your modem. Your heart is your hard drive. Your limbs are your mouse and the cables connected to the tower. What you see, hear, say, talk, walk, touch is actually downloaded on a DVD. In this life, you can hide it from your parents. But in the hereafter, will be uploaded in front of everyone that thought that you were Abu Bakr, but indeed you were Abu Jahl. So the question is, will you be proud of this DVD? Think, when you're all alone, you know what the scholars say? لَا تَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ أَهْوَلَ النَّظِرِينَ إِلَيْكَ. If you fear people and you don't fear your Creator, there's something wrong in the measuring stick of that heart. There's something of the mentality and the attitude that you have, that I fear the creation, but I don't feel the Creator. But when in front of people, I fear them see me doing something, but when I'm all alone, the only one that sees me is Allah, it's okay. Imagine, you make Allah as the least of your worries of those who see you. Can't be right. That's one key in order for you to have it. How do you attain it? Qiyamul layl. How do you get this taqwa? Qiyamul layl. Not niyamul layl. You know, some of the brothers, Dr. Iqbal, hafidhahullah, he says, people, instead of saying qiyamul layl, staying up late night just before fajr to pray, it says niyamul layl. Just maybe I can throw it. And instead of qaylula, you make it laylula. What's the big deal? When you're all alone, nobody sees you except Allah, you prostrate, you put that forehead down. And I'll tell you why. When it comes to khushu' bar, don't you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the condition of seeking that knowledge and getting there? It says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ. That is the key, akhi. One of the keys is taqwa. That's how you attain it. When you're all alone, my brother and sister. So by the way, it's coming up in the month of Ramadan. That's why Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi'ala linked taqwa with fasting. Why? Because when you fast, it's a secret, as it is mentioned, a secret between you and Allah. You can eat and drink at any time. But in front of people, you don't eat and drink because it's the month of Ramadan. Oh, he's a righteous dude, a righteous dudette. But when you go home, you close all the doors, and the only door you open is the door of the fridge. Do you have taqwa? No. That's how you attain it. You be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu muttali'un alayh. Allahu muttadirun alayh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see me. Watches over me, and so on. Now the khushu' part. You heard, may Allah bless the brother. He says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Who? They're true successful ones, the true believers. What are the attributes, O Allah? First thing on that list, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Allahu Akbar. Who are they? One, the true successful ones. The one that won the 649? No. You have khushu', concentration, focus, pondering, reflecting about everything you do and say. Feel the connection. That's what the connection is all about. By the way, salah comes from the word sila, connection. So if you want to speak to Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi'ala, pray. You want Allah to speak to you, read the Quran. So how is this khushu' attained, you may ask? It's very difficult indeed. Most of us have the American expressway. Places to go, things to do, people to see. I have no time. Time is money, my man. And it ain't a thing funny in this land of milk and honey. It's all about money. I got to go, dude. I have no time for this. Allahu Akbar and the stuff that you tell me about. But you've forgotten one good thing. That one that you want to leave so fast, you want to pray and go right away, is the one that controls your fate. The one that controls your sustenance. The one that has the keys for heaven or hell. The one that will give you a job or deprive you of a job. That's the one you're trying to leave so fast. You got it all wrong, my brother. So this khushu' gets you there. This Prophet Muhammad ﷺ says, جُعْلَ الْقُرَّةَ عَيْنِي, the apple of my eye. The pleasure in this dunya was in the salah. He used to say, أَرِحْنَا بِهَا يَا بِلَالِ. He didn't say, أَرِحْنَا مِنْهَا. He says, give us comfort in it, O Bilal. He didn't say, let's get rid of it. So how do we usually pray? Most of us, or some of us, say, Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin, 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 you're out of there. Right? Remember that? The American Expressway. Now, that's if you're praying in your room. Nobody sees you. Your father's knocking on the door. You're praying, Alhamdulillah, and you're still listening to that. Your father knocks again, Allahu Akbar. Are you making a loop? Oh, yeah. You know, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu used to shake when he makes a loop. He used to make a loop. You know why? When he was asked, why do you quiver? Why do you tremble when you make wudu? Why are you shaking when you make a wudu? He says, أَتَدْرِي بَعْدَ قَلِيلٍ أَقِفْ أَمَامَ مَنْ. Do you know after a few minutes who I'll be standing in front of? Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi wala. Now this khushu'a, remember the way you prayed, fast American Expressway? Now, could you imagine somebody opens your door again? Same example, stay with it. Now I said, Alhamdulillah, of course. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. And instead of Qul Wallahu Ahad, it has to be from Baqarah. Alif Lam Mim. MashaAllah. Now, people are saying, look at the khushu'. That's amazing. How do you obtain? How do you get there, man? And you turn around and say, and I'm fasting too. MashaAllah, great khushu', man. Now, you know what Ibn al-Adhan, Rahim, he said, how do you attain khushu'? He was asked, how do you attain khushu'? It's very difficult to attain khushu'. How do you focus and concentrate? It's very difficult. Because while you say Allahu Akbar, he says, mean it. But sometimes we say Allahu Akbar, think what? My wife gave me a shopping list. If I don't get it, I'm toast. I have to buy my son a Nike. It has to be Air. What color? Yeah, gang color. I remember that. Oh yeah, my daughter now is getting close to get married. I have to save some money. And everything else, other than concentrating, you think about solving all your problems. As a matter of fact, one story that says a man comes out of a city, but that imam was very harsh. Didn't take any criticism. So nobody told him anything because he actually prayed three rak'at instead of four. So that outsider, the stranger, came in, yeah, imam, you only prayed three rak'at. He says, nope, I prayed four. He says, no. So how do you know? He says, see, I have four stores. In the first rak'at, I planned everything I have to do in the first store. And similarly with the second and third, I never got to my fourth store. So he says, when you say Allahu Akbar, mean it. You know what that means? Literally translate, Allah is greater. We know that Allah is the greatest. But indeed, in this specific case, Allah is greater. Than what? Than your job, your spouse, your children, money, bills, worries, everything else. At this time, Allah is greater. Let me give you a mission stick to make sure that you actually understand what I'm saying. You hear the sound. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. But you're watching this Bollywood movie where a boy loves a girl and the girl loves a boy. But there's a villain. Father. Luke, I'm your father. You will not marry. You shall not pass. Now, the directors get you so involved in the movie, you're actually telling the girl, run girl, elope, it's so romantic, go, it's love. And all of a sudden you see this boy and the girl actually listen to you and they run away. And you wonder, wow, a wahi ba'da Rasulillah? Is there inspiration, a revelation after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How could that be? That's the connection the brother is talking about. No. And, of course, The girl runs, and the boy runs toward her in a slow motion and smiles with a diamond twinkle. And the hair is in the air. And hopefully he's coming on a white horse. The pecs start moving, the six-pack is tight. And it's supposed to be a clear sky. But for a dramatic effect, it rains. And it's supposed to be a desert, barren desert, but a tree pops out of nowhere. Behind the tree, a set of dancers. And you have to watch what happened in the end. But you hear Allahu Akbar, and you still want to watch that movie. So what are you really saying? Allah is not Akbar. That movie is Akbar. But I'm watching my soccer game, man. It's FIFA World Cup. I'm cheering for my country. Or it's a cricket game. It's India versus Pakistan. You understand? You know, if you don't let go, and I'll teach you why he said that. I taught my kids this. As soon as you hear Allahu Akbar, you go like this with your hand. Why? Because it's a Sahabi radiallahu anhu did it. He had an axe in his hand as he was going down to chop the wood. He heard Allahu Akbar. On the way down, he let it go. What did he say? La burika fi tarqatin nudi alayhi salat. This strike is not blessed. So from now on, akhi and ukhti, if you hear Allahu Akbar, you can do the same. Let go. Nothing is greater than Allah. Because if you don't let go at this time, you're actually saying Allah is not Akbar. That movie is Akbar. That game is Akbar. That story is Akbar. Whatever it is Akbar. No. So according to him, if you want to attain khushu', when you say Allahu Akbar, mean it. Mean Allahu Akbar. Nothing is greater at this time than Allah. And it says, as if you see the Kaaba. And as if you see heaven on your right, hill on your left. And as if you are passing on the Sirat, this path, as thin and sharp as a sword, and dark as the darkest night. And as if your sins surrounding you are going to come down to destroy you. And this is your last prayer, because the angel of death has got an arrow pointing toward your back. He's going to take your soul anytime. This is your last prayer. Above all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching. Now, Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man rahmatullahi alayhi, he was actually asked, how do you attain khushu'? He says, I want you to think on a dark, cold, windy night. You're in the middle of the ocean. The ship sank, and you have, by the blessing of Allah, a piece of floating wood. You're holding on to your dear life. He says, hold on to your salah as you're holding on to that piece of wood that is going to save your life. And when you recite the Quran, ponder and reflect upon what you say. Imagine, visualize everything. A man comes up again to Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man rahmatullahi alayhi and all of our scholars. Ameen. He said, I finished the Quran in 3 days. He says, go back and recite the Quran like I am listening to you. He said, it took me 3 weeks. He says, go back and read the Quran like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is listening to you. He says, it took me 3 months. He says, go back and read the Quran like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is listening to you. He says, I couldn't get over the Fatiha. That's how you attain khushu', my brothers and sisters. So when you recite the Quran, you understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I have divided the Fatiha between myself and my slave. My slave and I. So you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. For what, Afi? For a father, for a mother, for a health, for the wealth, for the house, for the kids, for the job, for the brain, for the health that I have that I take for granted. For I'm a Muslim. For I still let us say that La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. For everything you've given me, O Allah. Have I been a grateful servant? And so on. That takes one lecture on its own. He said, when you bow down, as if you bow down to nobody else except Allah. You know, when you're reciting the Fatiha, when you look down to prostration, you know why? Of course, we're commanded, as in the hadith, I understand that part. Another mahal is sujood. You're supposed to look where you prostrate. But some other opinions, you understand why? You can't hardly wait to go down, to put your forehead to the ground, as a reminder where you created from, minha khalaqnahum. Minha khalaqnakum, wa fiha nu'idukum, wa minha nukhrijum taratan ukhra. From it we created you, so just in case you think you're the best thing that ever happened on the earth. And in it we are going to return you. So it makes you wonder, is this your last prayer? And how will this grave be for me? And from it we are going to resurrect you once more. Knowing that you will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi ula, and the first thing you will be asked about is your salah. What will you say? I didn't know. Okay, let's take you there quickly. عَبْدِ لِمَ لَمْ تُصَلِّي. My slave, why didn't you pray? On judgment day, where it's 50,000 years, the sun leaves its orbit close to your head, people will be drenched in the sweat. You will hear your name, أَيْنَ فُلَانِ إِبْنِ فُلَانِ. Where are you? Come here, stand before me. وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْؤُولُونَ. Stop before me, they certainly will be asked indeed. Nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. You can't come back, you can't bribe an angel. You can't hire a lawyer. You're standing in front of Allah, unclothed the way you were created, in front of everyone that was ever created, from Adam alayhi salam to the last person who walks on the face of the earth. Just come, halumma, come here. Stand before the God Almighty. Why didn't you pray? Lord, I was rich. I had so many stores. The yen is up, the dollar is down. I was busy. You think it will be accepted? No. Are you richer than Sulaiman alayhi salam? Richest king on the face of the earth. It did not deter him from worshipping me and listening to my obedient to my ordinance, my commands. It doesn't wash. So if you don't pray in this air-conditioned, comfortable room, you will pray. Two opinions. One opinion, you will pray in the hellfire, or you will pray at least on a piece of stone that comes from the hellfire where you prostrate. Choice is yours. Because the salah is a physical ibadah nobody else can make up except you. Somebody can make up your hajj or siyam or zakat after you die. But nobody is able to make your salah after you die. That's the first thing you will be asked on judgment day. If it was accepted, everything else will be accepted. If it's not accepted, nothing else will be accepted. So excuses come through. Now I make excuses. But it doesn't work, so you'll be thrown in the hellfire, or at least you'll make up the prayers there on a stone from the hellfire. The second person comes and hears that this man is going to hellfire because he said that I'm rich, but he didn't make it. So he goes the opposite direction. عَبْدِ لِمَ لَمْ تُصَلِّي. My slave, why didn't you pray? He says, I was poor. I was so poor. How poor are you, man? He says, are you poorer than Isa alayhi salam? He used to say, this earth is my bed, the heaven is my cover. Still did not deter him from worshipping me. He still goes and completes his prayer, either in the hellfire or the stone. The third one comes. عَبْدِ لِمَ لَمْ تُصَلِّي. My slave, why didn't you pray? He says, Lord, I was so good looking. I was a hunk. I was a hottie. I walked around. The girls just passed out. يَا أَرْضَ النَّهَدِّ مَعَلِكَ أَدِّي. God's gift to women. He says, أَنْتَ أَنْظَرُ مِنْ يُوسُفْ. Are you more youthful and beautiful than Yusuf alayhi salam? لَا وَاللَّهِ. It's impossible. أُوتِيَ شَطْرَ الْجَمَالِ. He was given half the beauty of creation, not just men. And before you think that you are, look at yourself in the mirror, brother, please. Wake up in the morning. And you wonder, you say, why am I not married yet? So you think about it. No excuse will be accepted then. What will you give to come back to this earth, knowing what you know on Judgment Day, that you will still be praying? How much would you pay to come back to this earth?
قال رب ارجعون لعلي أعمل صالحا فيما تركت كلا إنها كلمة هو قائلها.
Lip service. No lip service, أخي.
يا رب, take me back. I know, I've seen the light. I'm healed. I repent. I believe.
Take me back. Will you take me back?
No, كلا. Nay, not granted.
So scholar says, how much will he pay to come back and be able to pray? Anything? He says, أنت في هذه الأمنية.
You are living this wish. You are living this wish.
Don't blow it. There's a video that was linked a while back. That one brother, his name is Abdullah, and that screen comes in on his face only. And he said, the narrator says, Abdullah, ya Abdullah, what would you do then, what you know now, what you do then, knowing what you know now. And the camera takes out and he finds out Abdullah is a quadriplegic, he's paralyzed from the neck down. He can't move. He says, Amani, I wish. The first umniyah, he says, and asjud lillahi sajda. My wish, O Allah, to give me one more chance to be able to prostrate to you. And he says, if I am able to prostrate to you, O Allah, I want to die right there and then not come back again from prostration. Because there's one verse that scares me. يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَا لِلسُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ. On Judgment Day, when Allah comes in a way befitting His Majesty and exposes His leg in a way befitting His Majesty, that everybody will prostrate except a few. You know who the few are? The ones that did not pray in this life will stand up. Their back will turn into copper and you will not be able to prostrate to Allah. Can you imagine everyone in the creation prostrating to Allah except you? And you can't even eyeball a policeman or even a soldier. It says, are you eyeballing me, boy? Could you imagine? Now, look to another verse.
مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرُ. What brought you here in this terrible place? Saqar is beneath Jahannam.
The hellfire, the ranks, the darakat. Jannah's darajat, higher. Hellfire is lower.
The lower you go, 70 times hotter than the hottest fire on the face of the earth. And every rank down is 70 times hotter than the one above. Saqar is even lower. مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرَ. What are you doing here? What brought you in this place, miserable place?
What's the number one answer in the Quran?
قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُ
مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. Allahu Akbar.
فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّى وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى.
سبحان الله. عجيب.
He says, the first reason you're in the saqar, in this hellfire, miserable place,
قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We did not pray, O Allah. Now that I scared you half to death, let's go on the positive side. Work on the positive side. Now, what do you do in the last 5 minutes I have with you? What do you do? And what do you get if you pray? You already know if you don't. Let's go on if you do. First, look at the beauty. When you make wudu, you thought about it. You know your sins fall off. Or every part that you touch with water. When you gargle, the sins fall off, whatever you said. Same with your eyes. Your hand touched whatever your feet walk to, and the last drop of water, your sins clear. The end of that, you make Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. You make the shahada. Oh Allah, make me from the purified ones and the repentant ones. Wow, beautiful. Now you're pure from the outside, it's pure the inside.
You understand when you pray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you gifts for every prayer you prayed on the face of the earth on Judgment Day. Who will bring it to you? Angels will bring you gifts for every time you prayed on this earth. Have you not heard the hadith, for every time that you wash, as if it's the river, you're washing your body from dharan, sickness, illness, and whims and desires of the heart. For every letter you actually recite in the Quran is 1 multiplied by 10. Imagine how many letters, and some of the opinions actually multiplied even more in that prayer. You know, when you pray, Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula yubahi bikum al malaika. The angels recording who's praying when, especially two prayers in the darkness, the Fajr and Isha, if you pray in Jama'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bashir al mashya'een fi al-dhulam bin nur al-tam yawm al-qiyamah. You walk to the masjid, or you go to the masjid in Fajr and Isha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you illuminating guiding lights on Judgment Day. You say a few things. You ask Allah for guidance. He says, لِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. For my slave, whatever he asked, I will grant him. You say that the shahwat. You say, As-salamu alayka, ayyuha al-Nabi, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillah as-salihin. Have you ever pondered, reflected about that part? How many hasanat do you get when you say As-salamu alaykum? 10. So every time in the prayer, you say that, As-salamu alayka, ayyuha al-Nabi, O Messenger of Allah. And the hadith says, If man salla alayya salatan, sallallahu alayhi biha ashara. If you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send a salutation, and have mercy upon Prophet Muhammad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplies that for you 10 times more, 10-folds. But you don't stop there. Salamu alayna. May peace be upon us. Who? Ibadullah al-Salihin. And if you pray, you're among the Ibadullah al-Salihin. You're sending your salutation to about, let's say, 1 billion. Among the 2 billion Muslims, let's say 50% of us pray. 50% of that Muslim Ummah pray, which is 1 billion. So 10 times a billion, 1 billion is 10 billion hasanat for every time you say the shahwat. And doesn't stop there, because also they send the salutation back to you, because they say the same thing. As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi as-salihin. You understand, akhi, the hasanat and the rewards, you let slip through your fingers. Not to mention that as-salah ila as-salah mukaffiratun lak. Ma baynahum. When you pray a prayer, another prayer, God Almighty expiates the sins, the minor sins. Illa lamam, of course. Not, don't kill a man and come back and say, Allahu Akbar. Yeah, it doesn't work that way. I'll rob a bank and go, Allahu Akbar. It doesn't work that way. These are the minor sins. Lamam. Major sins, it needs its own repentance. Who doesn't want this beautiful gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for yourself? And by the way, the prayer was so honored because the only obligation that was actually ordained in the heavens. And the Isra and Mi'raj. You understand, akhi? You want the peace of Isra and Mi'raj? Pray. You want to talk to Allah? Pray. You want to purify your sins? Pray. You want to be resurrected with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Pray. Lastly, with an invitation. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Kull ummati fil jannah. Illa man aba. My whole ummah is in Jannah except those who refuse. Could you imagine an invitation to Jannah? Said, no thanks. It's okay, I'll pass. I don't want it. I don't want to live happily ever after. I don't have to work anymore. I can eat as much chocolate as possible. I don't want to wear robes anymore. Anything I want, I can get. No, it's okay. I'm good. Prophet Muhammad says, here is the path. Take it, accept the invitation. Says, who ya'ba, who refuses? Is man ata'ani dakhala al-jannah. If you obey me, you will enter Jannah. What do you say? As-salah, as-salah, as-salah. Prayer, prayer, prayer. There is nothing left for you in the hereafter if there is no prayer. Remember the musib fi salati? Says, this is mahr, qaleel. You want the hur al-ayn? You want the hur al-ayn, akhi? Says, this is a dowry. very little dowry.
So pray is your path to Jannah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he gathered us here in this dunya, the guides of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, make the signal very strong so we can be connected to Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula. Ameen. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallam ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in. Jazakum Allah khayr. Wa sallamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hmm.